Pobade would be taking his case on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which will be followed by a keynote lecture on hypertrophic cardiac myopathy by Dr. Kamal Sharma from BJMC Ahmedabad. Our expert panelists from for today's meeting are Professor Kamal H. Sharma, Professor Mohit Gupta, Professor V.S. Narayan, and Professor Ranjan Kumar Sharma. A very warm welcome to all of you, sir. And on behalf of Ajanta, I would like to salute all of the doctors who have been true warriors in the current pandemic battle. Big thank to all of the doctors, sir. So this we have gone through previously also. So the Ajanta is present in market to serve the healthcare needs worldwide since 1973. We are known for first to market products in India. In last 10 years, we have introduced more than 150 such products which are first to market in India. And we are spread across 30 countries with more than 6,500 Ajantites working in 28 different countries. We have very strong R&D thrust with more than 750 scientists who are working in state-of-art facilities with a complete value chain in R&D. And we have presence in cardiology, diabetology, along with we have presence in ophthalmology, dermatology, and pain management. And our moderator for the overall program, we welcome Professor S.C. Mandal. Dr. Mandal is HOD of IPGMER and SSKM hospital. He has been examiner of DM as well as DNB cardiology and been principal investigator of many trials. And Dr. Mandal has published many papers, approximately 50, both national and international journals. And he has also published many chapters in many books. And he has been faculty and speaker in both national and international conferences. Thank you, sir, for giving us this opportunity to be part of this highly academic program. And our expert panelist for today's evening, Professor Kamal H. Sharma, is a professor from BJMC Ahmedabad. Professor Mohit Gupta is from GB Pant Hospital, New Delhi. Professor Dr. V.S. Narayan from KGMU, Lucknow. And Professor Ranjan Kumar Sharma from NRSMC, Kolkata. A very warm welcome to all of the panelists and all of the delegates. With this, without taking much time, I would request Dr. S.C. Mandal to kindly start the meeting, sir.
Good evening. Welcome to all the DM and DNB PGT to the Ajanta Cardio Master Workshop. It's been a pleasure to introduce that there are four eminent panelists today in this meeting. You know, already heard the name, Dr. Kamal Sharma, Dr. Ranjan Sharma, Dr. Mohit Gupta, and Dr. V.S. Narayan. I think without wasting time, I will ask Sunil to present the patients. Sunil, please, just start.
Good evening to everyone, sir. I am presenting a case of 30-year-old male patient, farmer by occupation, came to hospital with chief complaints of exertional breathlessness since 4 years, exertional chest pain relieved by rest since 2 years, and palpitation and giddiness 2 months back. The patient experienced breathlessness when he quickly climbed to staircase 4 years ago. We settled quickly. He started to get breathlessness on exertion like walking in his palm up to 2 kilometer or climbing 2 flights of stair, suggestive of NYHA class 2 dyspnea. He restricted his activities and felt better. He remained asymptomatic with restricted activities. Breathlessness gradually progressed to doing household activities like dressing, undressing, taking bath, climbing 1 flight of stairs, suggestive of NYHA class 3 over last period of 1 year, and which is relieved by rest. He visited for that a nearby physician who told him that he has some heart disease and started on tablets, taking which patient remains stable. There is no history of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea or orthopnea, no history of cup with expectorant or fever or seasonal variation or wheeze. Since last 2 years, he also started complaining of exertional chest pain for last 2 years, which was left-sided squeezing type, and which was relieved by rest. There is no history of radiation or associated sweating, no history of giddiness. He used to stop exertion when he feels discomfort, and chest pain used to get relieved by rest. Initially, NYHA class 2, which gradually progressed to NYHA class 3 over last 1 year. He also had an episode of fast sudden onset palpitation while watching television 2 months ago. Associated with that, he felt giddiness and transient loss of consciousness. He quickly recovered complete consciousness within few seconds, and palpitation also settled. There's no post-rectal confusion or involuntary urination or tongue bite. There's no history of exertional giddiness or postural symptoms, no history of edema, feet, abdominal pain, decreased appetite, no history of hemoptysis or hoarseness of voice, no history of bluish discoloration of skin or mucous membrane, no history of prolonged fever, migratory joint pain or skin lesions. On past history, there's no history of joint pain, any diabetic mellitus, hypertension or any history of injections, intramuscular injection, no history of cyanotic spill in the childhood or sweating episodes. No history of repeated respiratory tract infection. Personal history, patient is non-smoker, non-alcoholic, no drug addiction, bladder okay. And in family history, there's no history of any sudden death. His father is diagnosed to have heart disease, which he was told similar to his problems. And his mother has undergone a CABG a few years back. His younger brother is asymptomatic. So, sir, at the end of history, I've kept these differential diagnoses. First, sir, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Please don't show
the differentials. Before you start your differentials.
Don't show the differentials. Go back.
Yeah. So before, just go back. Yes, Dr. Mohit, you were asking something?
Yeah. So you have given a very quick and a rapid history of a case. And as is very evident that you have tried to describe the three symptoms in that sequence of dyspnea, of palpitations also, chest pain and palpitations, and also presyncope. Palpitations into presyncope. You have described that the dyspnea occurred on quickly climbing these stairs. So what do you mean by quickly climbing? Was this a routine activity for the patient or not? So whenever you are giving a history, it should come as that every point should go in flow. The dyspnea was progressive. It was progressive from class. You see that. Quickly climbed stairs 4 years ago and one flight of stairs. So all these things you have to clarify that what is quickly for him? Is it a normal or is it a normal activity for him? Is he doing this kind of activity every day? Is it suggestive of a class 2 NYHA dyspnea for him? That is number one. Second thing that you said, that one flight of stairs. So what do you mean by one flight of stairs? What accounts for one flight of stairs?
Sir, one flight of stairs, in general, normally 12 stairs, sir. And
so there is a very clear definition given for a block in a flight of stairs that one should be aware of. So one flight of stairs is 12 stairs, you know, that's typically described by the Canadian classification. So whenever you are using these terms, we should be very clear. Flight of stairs is a very standard term, okay? So flight of stairs is 12 steps. If it is more than that, then it goes into the second flight. And the block is also similarly, it is described by chest pain. So would you like to refine your dyspnea history, breathlessness history in this case? What would you describe?
For climbing a flight of stairs was normal for him, but suddenly 4 years back, after climbing the staircase, he felt dyspneic, which was not present previously.
So anybody who climbs quickly climbs a staircase generally would tend to get breathless. So my suggestion would be that whenever you are categorizing, he said that you can say that he experienced unusual breathlessness on routinely climbing the stairs. You understand? Your aim is that you are classifying that this patient is developing a symptom on climbing breathlessness, isn't it? So you have to classify that how this activity, which he used to do earlier, was not causing, and now it is causing that. That will give examiner a very quick information rather than this, which will invite unnecessary questions. The second point you have said is very right, that he remained asymptomatic with restricted activities. That means he was hovering between class 2 dyspnea. So you have to refine that particular. Okay. That is from my side that I would like to ask, and then other people can.
About the palpitations, you did not describe what was. Was it regular or it was an irregular palpitation?
Irregular.
Sir, it was only one episode, which was fast and regular, sir, and suddenly.
Not mentioned. Because that is that sometimes you can have atrial fibrillation and you can have a loss of consciousness during the spontaneous conversion to sinus rhythm. Or it can be VT, or you can have AF with very fast ventricular rate. So you have to describe in that fashion what is the nature of palpitations.
Perfect. So you see, the sir is very clearly pointing out that whenever you describe palpitations, the first question that you should expect is that your history should convey whether it is a volume overload palpitation or a rhythm-related palpitation, isn't it? Irrespective of the case, we are not sure what you are dealing with. So your history should say that it is a sudden onset and a sudden offset, isn't it? Yes. If it is like that, it is more likely to be a arrhythmic palpitation. So that is how you should go about it. Every single sentence that you make, not 20 sentences, every sentence that you should make should give a very clear information. Okay, and then you have very nicely ruled out that there is differentiation from a seizure activity. So this is not a presyncopal related to a seizure. That is a good sign that you have very nicely done this. So, and one thing is that you should always use the words for and since are different. He is having dyspnea for 2 years and he's having dyspnea since 2010, 20 or 1 year. Okay, so this is how you have to play with the words. So you have predominantly described very classically dyspnea, palpitations, and presyncope and chest pain, all these things.
Yes.
Out of the nature of chest pain, again, I have not described properly. How the was there any radiation to that, or after how much of activity, or is there an increase in the intensity of angina over the years of 2 years?
Yes, actually, chest pain was, sir, was associated with the exertional chest pain and used to get relieved by rest. And there is no history of radiation or associated sweating or giddiness, sir.
Do you get angina on exertion? Patients get sweating? Exertional angina, do the patient get sweating?
No, sir.
So why do you bring in this?
What he's asking you, is this anginal or is it non-anginal?
It's anginal, sir. It's anginal because...
The next question is often asked is, what are the definition of a typical angina or atypical angina or non-angina? That's some usual questions. So, this is central chest pain coming on exertion, relieved on rest. So, you get all three. So, this is classical or typical angina.
Yes, sir.
And as Dr. Mohit was pointing out, don't try to use too many adjectives. You know, quickly, rapidly, slightly, moderately. Don't use these terms in your history because they will get you into unnecessary trouble.
Yes, sir.
So your angina definition, as Dr. Narayan and Dr. Sharma has already pointed out, any symptomatology for the sake of our students, when you're describing, and if you don't remember what points to remember or forget, there is an acronym which we learned in our undergraduate days. It is called script FADO. So a script stands for site, character, radiation, intensity, P for T for time of the day, factors, FADO, F for factors aggravating and relieving, duration and onset. So these are the things, factors aggravating, relieving. So if those things you have to describe for angina, claudication, just try to correlate whatever symptoms are there, you know, just don't end up responding. And then as Dr. Narayan was saying, that you'll be, those will define your typical and atypical angina.
So having described this very nicely.
Yeah, Dr. Sharma has, you know, opened up another question when he said situational. So what are the situational anginas, you know, that you give you a clue to the diagnosis?
Come on, easy.
Sunil, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Could you hear Dr. Narayan's question? Situational angina. What are the situational angina?
Situation, koi bhi, in particular.
Like, sir, postprandial angina.
What does postprandial angina tell you?
Postprandial angina is seen in severe coronary artery disease after meal due to redistribution of blood flow from coronary to splanchnic vessels.
No, that is the mechanism.
Mechanism, but
where does it point you to? What does it tell you?
It tells you, significant coronary artery disease.
It speaks of severe. And if you get relieved after meals, if the angina gets relieved after meals, you feel better. Your angina is better.
It suggests more like the esophageal or...
No. Within the cardiac diagnosis which you are making, what happens if we have vasodilatation? The patient who has left ventricular outflow tract obstruction in the subvalvular region, what does vasodilatation do?
Aggravate the symptoms, sir. There yes. will be,
or it feels better.
There will be
increase. So go back and read this situational angina. These are the questions that will be asked. An angina which gets better on exertion, an angina which comes out only at night, an angina which gets aggravated, which gets better on meals. So all these things you should go back and read. What is what the angina which gets better on exertion?
Now that sir has asked you certain situational, there are again some day-wise or activity-wise or people named angina. What is Herbertin's angina? And so Fidipidi's angina?
That for all types of questions. That is what we are saying. You know, just don't go with your
angina,
fixed diagnosis of
HOCM. Angina.
So have an open mind. No, questions will be asked all through cardiology. That's what VIBA is all about.
Yes, sir.
So go back and read. I mean, the idea of these sessions is to stimulate you to read.
Now, without going on this thing, what are, don't show that slide, what are the possibilities that you think? You have a young male who is having progressively increasing breathlessness and chest pain and a single episode of palpitations leading to syncope. Don't go, as sir has very rightly said, don't think that this is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. What are the possibilities that you can have? A reasonably young man, what are the possibilities? What are the broader categories that you can have?
Patient can have, sir, valvular heart disease, particularly of rheumatic origin. Second, congenital heart disease, sir.
Valvular of what?
Valvular heart disease. What valvular heart disease would have these kind of symptoms?
Progressing and followed by chest pain, suggestive of more likely left-sided obstructive lesions associated more likely is the combined mitral stenosis with aortic stenosis.
With why do you want to bring in mitral stenosis here?
So, as dyspnea was the first complaint, sir. Then he started following chest pain, then giddiness. The long duration of dyspnea of 4 years.
Does he give a history? You really think yes, that this is the type of history which you get in mitral stenosis?
You see, when you get a patient of mitral stenosis and aortic stenosis, what will happen the symptoms of breathlessness? Is it just only adjustment breathlessness?
No, sir. History, patient will present with a history of PND and orthopnea, sir.
So why is PND not so common in HOCM? Is it common or uncommon?
It is uncommon, sir. Initially.
Why? What happens during sleep? What happens to SVR? What happens to... YPND, what happens to heart rate? What happens to contractility during sleep, REM sleep, non-REM sleep?
Sir, during sleep, there is increase venous return to the RV, which will lead to increase pulmonary blood flow. So there will be...
So increasing volume, venous return because of supine posture increases the LV volume. That is one. Number two, but that is countered by what happens to the SVR, systemic vascular resistance during sleep? It goes up, down?
It goes down, sir. But also, simultaneously, there is a...
So what happens in REM sleep? Or non-REM sleep? Which of them is associated with arrhythmias?
REM sleep. REM sleep is associated with arrhythmias.
And PND is associated with REM or non-REM?
REM sleep, sir. REM sleep.
So then why still the patients of HOCM don't get it? Something else. What happens to heart rate?
Heart rate will decrease, sir. So there will be increased filling time, and that will decrease the LVT obstruction and LVDP.
Happens to the force of contraction?
Force of contraction will decrease, sir, due to decrease sympathetic activity.
Again, the other question was angina that gets or dyspnea rather than paradoxical dyspnea relief. Which condition you get that? Patient has got dyspnea, starts walking, feels better.
Sir, I mean, coronary artery diseases only.
No. Dyspnea patient feels better on exertion. Paradoxical dyspnea relief.
Aortic regurgitation, sir.
Correct. Why?
Due to exertion, there will be decreased SVR, systemic vasodilation will
What happens to heart rate when you exert?
Also increase, and there is a decrease diastolic spleen time.
Correct. So there is shortening of diastole when the heart rate goes up, and the regurgitation amount with duration is less, so amount of regurgitation goes down, and hence probably there might be paradoxical dyspnea relief. All right. Why, as sir was saying, what is the difference, as Mandal sir was asking, why do you think it, what goes against mitral stenosis here? One thing is, I mean, you say it is MS because you have dyspnea ahead of angina, which you again, otherwise you think that in aortic valve, that should not happen, or subaortic, but HOCM it can happen. But what, again, what else goes against mitral stenosis?
Syncope, sir, will not be common.
Okay, syncope is not so common in MS, fine, but still. Something else? What is the age of the patient?
30-year-old, sir.
And dyspnea is how many years?
Dyspnea since 4 years, sir, only. There should be long duration in MS, sir, more than...
What about arrhythmias that you described?
Arrhythmia was sudden onset and sudden offset, sir.
So what makes you think that this is... So you think it's what, as Dr. Sharma was asking, it is atrial fibrillation, or I mean supranodal or infranodal? It's VTVF, or it's, I mean, you're dealing with an AFib?
More likely, sir, it's ventricular tachyarrhythmia.
Ventricular tachyarrhythmia.
No, rephrase. You think it is a VT, or is it something else?
What is more likely to happen?
In patient with MS, sir?
No. Your case, assuming that it is an HOCM.
Yes, sir. More likely possibility of, sir, ventricular tachyarrhythmia in young patient. No,
VT is common, sir, but the patient, does he stay, does he have just, if he has palpitation, usually in this patient already had an episode of syncope, which was not associated with palpitation. Now he has palpitation but did not have syncope at the same episode. Does that give you some hint? Is atrial fibrillation common in HOCM? Not so common in HOCM.
It is common, sir. Almost 20-25% patients may have.
Correct. So why that is so?
Due to sir, one is diastolic dysfunction, another is associated MR and which.
Correct.
Is...
2/3.
LA enlargement, sir.
Correct, LA. So usually, what do you get? That's why you get triple heave. No, hypertrophy of the LA. That's what they call it. So hypertrophied LA, though even you may not have a dilated LA, you have a hypertrophied LA, and the impulse has to travel into the muscle all throughout. It's not just it's transmitted intraluminally or extraluminally. So the whole muscle fiber itself has a refractory period. So thickness itself is going to contribute to the amount of the time that the impulse takes. And that's going to always let a APC coming in from the pulmonary veins find a part of muscle which has recovered from the refractory period. So then circuitous movements can always come into these patients despite LA not being more than 45 or 40 as we usually find in mitral stenosis, apart from the other two things that you mentioned, right?
So what do you think now? Where do you narrow down now? Would you like to present a clinical examination?
He has a long list of a DD.
Yeah,
sure. You said HOCM, yes. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy 1, mitral stenosis with aortic stenosis, which we have discussed. What about coronary artery disease?
Coronary artery disease, as sir has very, very rightly said, why you have put HCM as the first one? What makes you think that this is HCM? Can HCM be the first diagnosis in this?
Symptoms, typical all three symptoms, and
it could be coronary artery disease.
It can be coronary, or it can be aortic stenosis.
Or it could be a young patient presenting with a coronary artery disease, progressive being within breathlessness. Patient is having a chest.
There is one history in your history which tells that it's probably HOCM. What is that?
It started with dyspnea, sir. Actually,
No. What is your family history? Can you go back to that slide and show?
Father had a bypass,
and father and mother did not have the same disease. So probably father did not have a CAD and was having HOCM. So otherwise you would have said both had similar disease. You've mentioned that father and son have same disease. Mother had a bypass.
Yes.
Right. Mother had CAD. Father did not have CAD, but had a similar disease like
He died suddenly. And he also went on to add that the younger brother is not yet symptomatic.
Yeah.
So he was trying to get us to the diagnosis.
That's very right, but you know, even you can say it's in coronary artery disease, it also runs in families. So
absolutely,
if you see the occurrence of disease of coronary artery will be much more common as compared to the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, isn't it? What will be the prevalence of a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy as described in current literature?
Currently 1 is 200, 1 is 500.
So basically you will have a coronary artery disease chances, so everything can fit in. If I say this is a coronary artery disease, how do you explain presyncope in this case? What kind of diseases in a coronary artery disease can give you a presyncopal episode? What kind of involvement can give you a presyncopal episode? Aram se soch ke batao. Just you will have a no. Post typically syncope ho jayega. There are only two diseases that can occur in coronary artery disease that can cause a syncope. Typical arrhythmia, syncope, patient and recovers. Chest pain with syncope. So it's in right coronary artery involvement one can have. Definitely presyncope. And it can be in left main involvement one can. Isn't it? So yes. Once you have an open, see, that is why the purpose is not to present the case. You keep your mind open. So your diagnosis should not reflect that you know the diagnosis. You may be knowing that is a separate issue, but you should show that yes, coronary artery disease, and you should say that what are the points against, what are the points for. So once, as you have said, that there is a history, which is a familial history, then probably rheumatic will come a little bit lower down. A coronary artery disease could be the first one. Then the second one could be definitely a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This is agreeable. Every examiner will buy this particular concept. But if you say, no, it's definitely hokum, then it makes the thing very agreeable. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Sunil, why
is
he not...
Is hypertension uncontrolled only?
Yes, sir. It can be a possibility. Sir.
Because MBP, can you explain this typical angina in MBP?
Yes, sir.
You have a very typical angina in this patient for 2 years. Can you explain in patients of MVP angina?
Sir, MVP, the angina is not common and is generally atypical, sir.
We really would not consider MVP here. So, I mean, certain times you just don't have to keep on going on with the list. So, MVP, nobody will, you know, sort of accept patient in class 3 symptomatology, so many things happening. MVP is a very, very unlikely. I mean, I would never consider MVP.
So, Sunil, what is about correct transposition of gait at LTGA? 30 years old, syncope, chest pain, shortness of breath.
Yeah, that's what I was asking. If he said congenital heart disease, what were the congenital heart diseases that he would have considered? So that was I was asking, and then he went to sort of mitral stenosis. Answer that question. I mean, think it's an interesting question.
Atrial ASD or sir with VSD PDI?
No. He says, can it be an L transposition of great vessels, great arteries, some kind of blocks?
Yes, sir. It can be, sir. CCTJ.
The only thing is that, you know, it's a very late presentation, the age of, you know, 30 years. That is quite sort of rare. But yes, if you are considering a congenital heart disease, you can have a congenital heart block. We can manifest at a later age, and then you can have an underlying L transposition of great arteries, which can be really asymptomatic at this age also. So what we have just tried to tell you is that keep all your possibilities open. See, in the examination, there are two things that are going to happen. Either you will get a live case if things and conditions, you know, allow us to have that, you know, 1:1 interaction on the real case. But you would, by and large, know the diagnosis of that case. And the second thing is that when you present it virtually, you obviously know what you are sort of manufacturing. So the drawback is that you go with a fixed diagnosis and you don't want to look here and there, and then you get, you know, sort of entangled. So always keep all the possibilities open, starting from congenital heart disease to rheumatic heart disease, to hypertension, to coronary artery disease, to miscellaneous muscular pericardial, everything. So start like that. Always I say, diagnosis, congenital, yes. What are the possibilities? MS, rheumatic, yes. What are the possibilities? Then hypertension, yes. Coronary. So consider all the possibilities, you know, sequentially. Or if the other way around, the more important one first and the least relevant ones that asked. Okay, so I think we've done half an hour.
Yeah.
Let's get on to this sort of.
Yeah, so if another thing is, if you don't remember anything congenital coming to your mind, remember bicuspid aortic valve is also a congenital disease. So bicuspid is always a different.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. That's why he's put it there.
Yeah.
It's just that he didn't.
It mentioned.
So, in fact, actually, he has put in everything: muscle, rheumatic, coronary, congenital. Pulmonary arterial hypertension, yes, that's a very strong possibility. But the only thing is that you don't get so much of syncope, but a mitral valve collapse, okay. So let's go ahead, I think.
Yes, one somebody has put a question in chat box. Can this be pulmonary stenosis? What is your take, Sunil? Can this be pulmonary stenosis and have the same symptoms? Some other student has asked this question in chat.
Yes, it can be a possibility, sir, of pulmonary stenosis.
Class 3 dyspnea.
Unlikely, very, very unlikely to have dyspnea unless you know the patient is sort of misplacing fatigue for dyspnea. Otherwise, to have a class 3 dyspnea with pulmonary stenosis or even with primary pulmonary arterial hypertension would be very difficult to accept.
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead. Sunil.
On general examination, patient is conscious, comfortable, cooperative. There is no palar icterus, sinusitis, clubbing, or edema pit. Height 170 centimeter, weight 60 kg, BMI 20.7 kg per meter square. No features of any infective endocarditis, mark on inhibitors, dysmorphic facies, or skeletal deformities or skin lesions. Pulse is 60 per minute, regular, normal volume, rapid rising, perseverance character. Bilateral carotid is equally palpable, non-collapsing. All pulses failed. There is no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. On blood pressure, is 116/70 mmHg taken in right upper limb in supine position and 120 mmHg systolic in right lower limb. JVP, mean JVP is 3 cm above the sternal angle. Normal
left upper limb? Left upper limb, you didn't mention, but I'm sure you have taken in all four limbs. Why is it important between two limbs? Which other case? Which other long case or short case you can have?
When he talks of LVOT obstructions, he has to consider all three, subvalve, valve, and supravalve. I mean, at this point of time, till this point.
Yes, sir. Both upper limb BP is same, sir, actually.
Okay.
No, but if the difference was there, what was it pointing to?
It can point, sir, coarctation aorta and aorto arteritis.
Yes.
In your case,
what is that? Condyle effect in supravalvular AS.
Correct.
There will be a difference between right.
And the difference should be more than
20.
Okay, so generally 10, but some books write 20 also.
What's that called as? What effect?
Condyle.
That I have already told you.
Condyle effect, sir.
Okay.
It is due to selective streaming of the.
Okay, done. So you must mention. Whenever you are taking LVOT obstruction, say that the upper lower limbs are significant.
You have mentioned JVP mean is 3 cm. Mean, how did you measure the mean pressure?
That's the most difficult question to answer. JVP is one examination which is so difficult. And this is the question which people ask. So let's make it very clear. What are we saying? Whenever you see, how do you measure mean JVP, the mean pressure on the JVP? So when you see the upper limit of the JVP, at 45 or whatever angle, what are you seeing? Are you seeing the height of the A wave, height of the V wave, or you are seeing the mean pressure?
Mean pressure, sir. Height of the mean pressure we are seeing.
Mohit saab, bataiye. Kya padhate hai? Bahut confusing hai.
No. Mean is a sum of your A, X, Y, descent. Everything you have a. You see the height of the A, that is the highest in right side. In a normal JVP, what you see is upper level is top of A. It's not the mean of JVP.
Okay.
Yeah, that's where I said that lots of things have to be. So generally people will say that this is the JVP is raised and it is so many centimeters above the angle of Lewis. But if you cut it very fine and start, how do you get to the mean pressure? Then of course it's very difficult to assess mean pressure by the JVP because getting to the A wave height and then the B wave height and then calculating is pretty difficult.
Okay, tell me, normally in this particular case, what would you expect?
Yeah, please.
Ye batao. Yes. You see, knowledge is piling up of facts, wisdom is simplifying it. So not everything that you know should be told and not everything that is being seen should also be presented. If you present a question like this, what will happen is, and sir is there, then you will have a really tough time. So basically, we have to be very, very clear. So ab mujhe batao, what do you expect in this case? Soch ke batao. The diagnosis is AS. And the diagnosis is HCL. Both are okay, taken now. Okay, na? Dono mein ek finding mil sakti hai badi commonly. What would be that finding? And what is that called? Yeah.
Sir, A wave, tall, dominant A wave will be seen due to burning effect.
Mil sakta hai uske andar. Toh, ab tumhe simple sa bolna tha ki, were you able to see that or not? You say ki JVP, this was wave was seen. Otherwise, you say it is unremarkable, it is fine, and you move ahead. If you present like this, then you know the whole viva will completely die.
I hamesha ek inko mnemonic batata hu bachchon ko ke.
Ji sir.
If you have atrial fibrillation, you are very happy. Whatever wave you are seeing is the wave. Now, if you don't have atrial fibrillation and you are seeing only one wave, it is the B wave. If you are seeing a case of pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary arterial hypertension, say it is. If you are seeing two waves. And you have a case of PS or pulmonary arterial hypertension, say it is the A wave which is prominent. If you have getting a tricuspid regurgitation predominant, say it is the V wave which is prominent of the two. And if you still can't say anything, just say both are prominent. So atrial fibrillation, V wave. One wave, CV wave. Two waves, if you are PS-PH, A wave is prominent. If you have TR, V wave is prominent. And you can't decide, then you say the JVP is raised, both NV are prominent.
Okay.
And no examiner will question you on that because nobody is able to sort of really get to the get to grips with JVP.
Chalo, next.
Okay. So
you describe the bisphenia characters of the pulse. What do you mean by a bisphenia pulse?
Sir, it's a double beating pulse felt in the carotid artery based.
Bisphenia, there are two peaks, right?
Yes, sir, two peaks.
Double beating. Both the peaks are where?
Both peaks are in systole, sir. Single systole.
Both the peaks.
Which are the twice beating pulses? Which one are the pulses which beat twice?
One is, sir, bisphenia pulse. Another is dichrotic pulse. Third is, sir, pulses, spike and dome pattern in HOS.
Why to bata rahe ho tum? That is what you are saying here. Bisphenia is spike and dome is bisphenia. But it is characteristic of
anachrotic pulse.
Correct. So anachrotic, bisphenia, and dichrotic. Correct. Now bisphenia, you get in again two disorders. What are they? One you mentioned. Second one.
Second in AR, sir, aortic regurgitation.
Pure AR or something else?
Severe AR or AS?
Moderate AS with severe AR will have.
So how do you differentiate the two?
The peak of the first peak, the in bisphenia, the two peaks will be at same level, and in bisphenia there is a in HOCM there will be a early spike and later there will be dome patterns.
Why is it so?
Because, sir, in HOCM, due to hypercontractility, around 80% of the blood is ejected in the early systole. Due to another second half systole, there is an obstruction which leads to decrease in blood flow and which leads to dome pattern.
Is the cause of the second wave in HCM?
Due to prolonged contraction after obstruction, sir.
What else? Any other theory has been given? Chalo, this is complex. There are two ways people have tried to interpret. Okay. Chalo, aage chalo. Next, quickly. Go ahead.
On systemic examination, inspection and palpation, chest is symmetrical. There is no...
Just tell us the positive findings because you have to...
Yeah.
The apex BTs are in fifth intercostal space outside the clavicular line. Apex beat on a palpation felt in 15 to possible outside the midclavicular line, heaving in character with double impulse with palpable S4. There is no thrill at apex, no left parasternal heave or palpable P2. A systolic thrill is felt in the left third intercostal space close to the sternum, better felt with patient standing. And percussion, no any positive findings. And auscultation, S1 is normal, S2 normal split, no S3, S4, S4 is loud at apex and no click or open snap at apex. There is a harsh mid-systolic murmur, high pitch, best audible in third and third left intercostal space close to sternum with diaphragm of the stethoscope, increases with standing and strain phase of Holzhalva, decreases on squatting and hand grip, not radiating to carotids, grade 4 by 6 murmur. There is another second late systolic murmur, blowing high pitch at apex, conducted to axilla, best heard with diaphragm of the stethoscope, better heard on standing and decreases on hand grip and squatting. Grade 3 by 6 murmur. There is no any other murmur. Respiratory system, other system examination is normal limits.
So in this particular case, Sunil, you have to be really be updated and very alert on the maneuvers, because this is going to be asked in HOCN case. The maneuvers will be asked.
Yes, sir.
So be prepared to answer each and every question on Valsalva, on all the other hand grip, squatting, this, that. Everything should be updated on that.
Yes.
So be really prepared. So let's, if you have to ask Dr. Sharma and Dr. Mohit, any questions on that, on the Valsalva? You can ask. But otherwise. Yes.
So we all know, as sir has very rightly mentioned, you'll be asked about Valsalva and everything, all the dynamic auscultation parameters. Because HOCM and MVP moved almost in the same direction on this, what are the dynamic auscultation findings that can help you differentiate the MR of the two? Are there anything that can help you to differentiate the two? Because everything else goes together, right?
Yes, sir.
So anything in dynamic auscultation that helps differentiate MR of MVP from MR of HOCM by doing some dynamic feature that you can differentiate the two?
Sir, hand grip can differentiate the murmur of MR of MVP will increase with hand grip. And due to increased afterload, the HOCM will decrease, sir.
So when you do a hand grip, when you increase systemic vascular resistance, you increase the systemic vascular resistance, you reduce the obstruction. So HOCM murmur reduces, but does it actually impact the murmur of MR? When you increase the SVR, MR of MVP will increase. That is fine. But does it change the murmur of MR in HOCM? Rather than that, it is the duration versus the intensity that changes, not the murmur per se disappearing. You know, it's in HOCM, it will be what will happen, because LV is more dilated, the amount of drag effect that you find of the anterior mitral leaflet would be for a shorter duration. So it's the length of the murmur that changes in HOCM, while in MVP, it's the intensity of the murmur. That's the important difference between the two of them. Other faculties, if you have any comments apart from this.
Perfect. That's a key point.
Yes, sir.
Again, can you differentiate S3? One maneuver that can differentiate S3 of LV dysfunction versus S3 of MR?
Standing.
S3, not the murmur. S3 of MR from S3 of LV dysfunction. Which one will disappear and which will be persist or decrease when you do something?
With the diuretics, the MR S3.
No, diuretics. You can give something else which is not available, theoretical again, not available in a day two. What happens with amyl nitrate?
With amyl nitrate, the MR S3 will disappear, sir.
Of?
MR, sir.
No. LV dysfunction, you reduce the afterload, so S3 disappears off? LV dysfunction, no. When you give amyl nitrate, you increase the venous return. When you increase the venous return, MR increases. MR increases, so S3 of MR will actually increase or will persist. While that is what is not dependent on volume, but dependent on systemic vascular resistance, will disappear. So when you reduce SVR, which is a determinant in S3 of LV dysfunction, it will dissolve. So you should know the simple hemodynamic effects of various things and how the things are brought out.
If you should know what happens when you give amyl nitrite. There are two things that happen in the first phase and in the later phase.
First phase, sir,
because of vasodilatation, something happens and then that increases the stroke. So you should be aware of what the physiology is, you know, partaking in there. Similarly with squatting, when you squat, suddenly what happens? There are two things that happen. Increase the peripheral vascular resistance, you decrease the venous return. Or in sudden squatting, you suddenly increase the venous return. So all these things, you should be mentally prepared to be asked and answered. One question that is often asked in Valsalva is, how do you differentiate between LV dysfunction, simple, and a volume load situation?
With Valsalva, sir, when there is LV dysfunction, the initial raise BP will remain elevated, and due to called square wave response, due to already elevated high sympathetic tone, there will be raised BP, and there will be no post Valsalva rising of BP.
Square root response.
Square root response.
Correct. So that you get in which condition?
In severe LV dysfunction, aortic stenosis, ASD, mitral stenosis, and
MS, ASD, correct, LV dysfunction. Okay, good. I mean, you got three out of four. So there are four conditions, sir. You got three of them.
Whenever you have volume load, you know, the ventricle continues to fill.
Yes.
So you don't have that dip. Continue to have a raised pressure.
Yes, sir.
When you have a missing of the overshoot, it is simple LV dysfunction. When you have a square root phenomena, then it is a volume load situation, which you can have in the four conditions which Dr. Sir has just mentioned.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, Neil.
Yes, sir.
By the marmoreal mitral regurgitation, can you tell that whether it's because of just it is due to SAM? Or due to intrinsic abnormality to the mitral valve in the HOCM?
Sir, it is likely, sir, due to SAM, because the murmur
No. Sir's question is very specific. How, by MR, what characteristic of MR will tell you what is the etiology of MR? Is it because of SAM, or it is because of some other abnormalities that are seen? And that means, what are those abnormalities?
One is, sir, radiation of the murmur. Here the murmur is radiating to the posterior axilla. Most likely the anterior leaflet is involved, so which is common in SAM. If the intrinsic abnormalities of mitral wall is there, the MR will be central or maybe anteriorly directed.
So basically, what are those intrinsic abnormalities of the mitral wall that are seen? Commonly in SCM?
Commonly, sir, there is a long anterior leaflet or abnormal papillary muscle insertion directly into the anterior leaflet without any cordy, or anterior displacement of the papillary muscle can be seen in SCM.
Can anything play a role vis-a-vis the intensity of the murmur of HOCM? Can that help you in differentiating the two? The dynamic murmur of HOCM versus murmur of MR, will it help in differentiating the two? Anomaly, whether it's the SAM which is causing MR versus the structurally abnormal. Got my question? That's what sir is asking you. If there is more SAM,
yes,
that means LVOT murmur will increase or decrease?
Will increase, sir.
So what will happen to MR also if there is more SAM?
MR murmur will also increase, sir.
Correct. So if it is because of anomalous, and then it's in the murmur of MR is independent of the murmur of HOCM, then it's structural abnormality. That's what sir is asking. If you have a SAM related, the intensity will go in proportion. While if it's not related, if it's structural abnormality, the murmur of MR will be independent of the LVOT obstruction.
Yes, sir.
That's how you differentiate whether you're dealing with a structurally abnormal or am I correct, sir? Plus the radiation,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah. You have to say both the maneuvers and also the jet and everything.
Yes.
So, okay. What causes the MR in cases of HOCM? Is it just the physiology, or is it an actual abnormality of the mitral apparatus?
Sir, it is seen that actual abnormality in mitral wall apparatus is there, sir.
So, what abnormality occurs? Sir, is there some criteria of coaptation which is mentioned in the books? the echo criteria of coaptation, coaptation points should be so much from the
four grades are sir, there in first grade.
Okay, so you know that. Okay, you're ready to answer that.
Yes.
So sometimes you have to repair it when you do surgery for HSCA. The mitral apparatus has to be repaired also.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Structural heart disease.
Provisional diagnosis.
So now you do not have any differential diagnosis. The only diagnosis you are left with is?
Yes, sir. Structural heart disease with severe LVOT obstruction in the form of HOCM with no congestive heart failure in NOHA class 3, no pulmonary artery hypertension, normal sinus rhythm, normal LV function with positive family history, possibility of complicated by sustained VT oblique ventricular fibrillation.
Why you have not mentioned primary venous hypertension?
Sir,
if Dr. Mandal is the examiner, you will have to answer that question because that's his favorite question.
Yes, sir. There, the P2 pulmonary, P2 is normal, sir. There is no signs of any
venous hypertension. In venous, you don't get loud P2.
Pulmonary venous hypertension. So what are the symptoms and signs of pulmonary venous hypertension?
You get from the history mainly.
That is why I said, what are the symptoms and signs of pulmonary venous hypertension?
Dyspnea is common, sir.
Yeah.
Class 3 dyspnea in pulmonary.
So if you have dyspnea, that points out, or then going from symptoms to signs?
If you have crepitations, then you can say otherwise.
So if you have basal crepitations or your crepitations right up to the epic, that's when you think of pulmonary venous. Yep. And if you have severe pulmonary arterial hypertension, then obviously it has to be preceded by pulmonary venous hypertension. You cannot have a secondary, you know, hypertension without pulmonary venous hypertension. So just, you know, some examiners like to hear pulmonary venous hypertension.
Yes.
So it is good to mention that.
Okay, sir.
What is the percentage of patients who get the pulmonary arterial hypertension in the HOCM? And how much?
It is rare, sir. It can be seen in at the burnout stage in 3-4% patients.
No. In latest European Heart Journal, they have seen 38% of patients develop pulmonary arterial hypertension. The systolic pressure is around 40-50 millimeter mercury. So this is mild, but 38% patients have got it.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
See, when the left ventricular and diastolic pressure is raised and there is no obstruction at the mitral level or the pulmonary venous, it is likely that the diastolic pressure in the pulmonary artery will be raised, and you will have some kind of raised pulmonary artery systolic and diastolic pressure. So the mean pressure, as Dr. Mandal is saying, if we measure the mean pressure in the pulmonary circuit, in a large number of patients, it will be found to be raised. If not severe, then at least between 20 and 35.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
So how you go ahead, Dr. Mohit, ab aap puchhe bhai, kya puchna cha rahe hain?
Sir.
Okay, describe.
So the ECG.
Yes, sir.
What do you think about the LVOT obstruction? You have not got any paradoxical second heart sound or decrease, and you have not got any prominent AOA. What do you think about LVOT obstruction? How much?
Severe LVOT obstruction, sir. There is a high pitch. Heart with systolic murmur is grade 4/6 is there.
You have got S4, you have got ST normal split, and there is no AO in the jugular veins. Clinically, what do you think about the LVOT obstruction? Is it there or not?
Yes, it is there, sir. LVOT.
He says severe. So what Dr. Mandal is trying to ask you, what are the signs of severe LV outflow obstruction in your case? Because you say S2 is normal split. In a severe case, you were expecting that there would be some kind of, you know, paradoxical splitting of the second heart sound.
Yes,
you were expecting. Yes, you have a fourth heart sound, and then you have a, what about the murmur, etc.?
One is, sir, S4, both audible and palpable. S4.
You have symptomatology. Then you have, first, of course, is you have symptoms of angina, of shortness of breath. So they also speak of severity.
Yes, sir.
Then among the signs, you have a left ventricular apex, a double apex, a palpable S4. Second heart sound, you could have sort of, since you were manufacturing the whole case, you could have said paradoxical splitting of the second heart sound.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Mandal?
Okay, go ahead.
Sir, 12-lead ECG.
Especially when you have a left bundle branch block also.
Yeah.
You could have sort of said paradoxical.
So what does this LVBB tell you about his management strategy?
Sir, pre-existing LVBB will be contraindication for alcohol septal ablation, sir, can lead to
why alcohol septal ablation will be relatively, not absolute, but of course contraindicated.
Sir, already pre-existing LVBB is there, and alcohol septal ablation can create RBBB, sir. So patient can land up in complete heart block. There will be need of
pacemaker. Correct. And so once you have an RBBB, suppose this patient had RBBB, would that have tilted in favor of something?
Then it will be better for myectomy, sir.
So this patient is better for myectomy?
Yes.
This patient is better for myectomy. And then if there was RBBB, and then you would go probably think of alcohol septal ablation, because alcohol septal ablation causes QRBBMI, right? Septal artery embolization will cause QRBBB.
Yes,
so sir. RBBB when you get, and then on top of that, if you have LBBB, you are more at risk of ending up with a pacemaker as a complication of the procedure. Right.
So 12-lead ECG with QRS more than 150 milliseconds with complete LBBB with normal axis around 60 degree. And there is secondary STT changes in one AVL V5, V6 with...
Okay, go ahead. Next, we have X-ray. Is there anything?
There was sinus rhythm with left atrial overload. Did you say that?
Yes, sir. There is a evidence of left atrial enlargement.
So you should say everything. You know, whenever, see, don't jump to LVB straight away.
Yeah.
When you are, you know, you have to present that X-ray in the examination. Start with rhythm. Tell us what the axis is. Tell us about the left atrial overload, right atrial overload. Then go to the QRS, then go to the ST segment and T wave changes.
Yes,
so go systematically. Always speak of the rhythm and then axis. And then, of course, you have to say about the atria, the ventricles, and the QRS duration, things like that.
There is evidence of left atrial enlargement and left ventricular
hypertrophy. Okay, so go ahead. Anything else? So the duration of the QRS is also important, because if you have a QRS duration more than 120, if you have a left bundle branch block, as Dr. Sharma was saying, relative contraindication to septal ablation, because you could, but since you are damaging the basal part of the septum where the right bundle is residing, so you can cause a seizure. Okay, X-ray.
Chest X-ray, PA view showing situs solutus leocardia with increased cardiothoracic ratio. With suggest of cardiomegaly of LV type, LV down and outs. There is a prominent left heart border, straightening of the left heart borders suggest of, and also increased prominent bronchovascular markings in the upper.
No, don't say bronchovascular markings. That's an absurd term. Don't use this word bronchovascular. Tell us whether it is pulmonary venous hypertension, pulmonary arterial hypertension. Don't say bronchovascular. This is radiological guy speaking.
Cephalization of the vessels suggests of pulmonary grade 2 hypertension, pulmonary venous hypertension. And There is no any obvious calcification or any bony abnormality.
Now, suppose I was to say that this is a case of mitral stenosis. What are my points against this X-ray?
LV, cardiomegaly LV is down and IOT.
I don't see the left atrium. The first thing is that I don't see the
large left atrium.
Can it be mitral regurgitation, pure simple mitral regurgitation with failure?
Yes, sir. It can be. Yes, sir.
I mean, most of the features are because of that. Because of the most of the X-ray features. So, good that you started with situs. Then you went to the cardiomegaly part. Then you start off from the right border. I always say start from the right border. Say whether there is severe vena cava prominence or not. There is zygote prominence or not. Then the left atrium, the right atrium. So here you have a right atrial prominence. Probably this is an expiratory film. The patient is either lying down or sort of he's not taken a good inspiratory breath. So you have that kind of false kind of cardiomegaly also. And some kind of increased vasculature is seen. But yes, there is pulmonary venous hypertrophy, there is left ventricle type of apex, there's left atrial appendicular filling also, then the main pulmonary artery is prominent. The aortic knuckle is not prominent. Then you have pulmonary venous hypertension and pulmonary arterial hypertension.
Yes.
Does it look like increased pulmonary blood flow to you? A soft film can give you an impression that this is, you have those end-on vessels. So you can see some of them, but this is not increased pulmonary blood flow. Sometimes in the examination, you get confused whether it is pulmonary venous hypertension or increased pulmonary blood flow. So the prominence of the veins definitely speak in favor of pulmonary venous hypertension. Anything else, Dr. Mohit, Dr. Sharma, you want
to... Perfect.
In this? So does it affect your diagnosis? Does it help you? Diagnosis, you?
With cardiomegaly, there it...
If you give this X-ray to me with that ECG, I would say this is dilated cardiomyopathy.
Yes, sir.
Because even though you are not seeing a left atrium here, I can see it very well in the ECG.
Yes, sir. It can be.
So echo, what's the diagnosis? You have echo report with you?
Yes, sir. Echo. On parasternal long axis view, there is significant septal and posterior hypertrophy. And on M mode, there is a systolic anterior motion of the anterior leaflet. So this is your SAM.
So this is severe?
No.
I'm not talking of the gradient. By looking at SAM.
Gradient.
It looks like it is more than one third of systole. There is a contact between.
So if there is no contact, then it is the distance of SAM from the septum, 10 millimeters or more.
Yes, sir.
The distance is more than less than 10, then you have a severe case. Severe. And then if it is in contact with the septum, of course, one third and 30%.
Yeah,
30%. So this 10% or more than 30%. So severe SAM, likely to be severe.
This is a color continuous Doppler at the LVOT, suggestive of peak gradient 160 mmHg at the LVOT, sir. With typical late peaking of dagger shape gradient.
It's not very classical. You have to imagine that this is dagger shape. You have more classical pictures available with you. Must have seen more classical Doppler signals of HOCM.
And the septal thickness on echo is 30 mm, sir.
So this echo doesn't tell you that what is the reason of HOCM is just that the fibers are in disarray or some kind of storage disease, some kind of,
Sir, HOCM most commonly involved is basal septum, and septum is most common site. And storage disorder, there will be more global involvement will be there.
So basically, you should be aware of the mimics of HCM, especially in the adults and everything. That is what, sir. So, yes. what are the common mimics, Fabry's disease, you know, it's a very underdiagnosed, can occur, amyloidosis can is one of the disconnected tissue disorders, you should be aware of.
Yes.
And what are the modalities to differentiate on echo as well as on the basis of MRI. MRI is a gold standard for differentiating them. There are separate criteria for Fabry's. Fabry's is probably one of the most underdiagnosed and one of the diseases which is actually quite there, but less number. So you should be aware of the mimics. That is what sir is asking. And the newer guidelines give you age-wise mimics of the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Okay. So point is well taken. That systolic gradient is 160. You know, the probably some level of dagger-shaped appearance. That is fine. Thank you, Maria. Now, with this kind of information, anything else would you like to have or you would like to go ahead with this thing? What comes to your mind that when peak gradient is above 100, you know, it is such a high gradient, irrespective of the availability of the modalities, what comes to your mind? What would be probably a better choice for this patient and why? What does the evidence say?
Sir,
can you manage?
For investigation purpose or treatment, sir?
Anyway, so let us go ahead and we'll discuss this later.
Do you ever catheterize these patients now? So much is spoken about the broken Barrow sign. Do you have to really sort of...
Sir, I have some tracings of cath also, sir.
You have, but do you do that? Do you catheterize these patients anymore?
No, sir. Actually, if there is any discrepancy between the non-invasive findings and patient symptom, then there is one indication. And again, to if there is an angina is there, so for to rule out coronary artery disease, we can catch.
So you can catheterize them to see for coronary, but generally to confirm the diagnosis, you generally would not
required. Chalo, go ahead.
This is tissue Doppler imaging at the septal mitral septal leaflet, suggestive of the E dash reduced to 3.
What is the E dash here?
E dash is less than 7 here, 3.29 centimeter per second. Suggestive of restrictive pattern of that is grade 3 dash will be.
Suggestive of muscle disease. And what is the E by E dash ratio?
Should be more than 14, sir, in this patient.
You did not do it. Okay. In the M mode, in the sort of, in the Doppler or even in the M mode, what does S4 correlate with?
S4 will correlate with, sir, A wave of the...
And why do you not normally hear the NS4 if a patient does not have any significant LV dysfunction? Why do you not hear it?
Sir, it is very actually low frequency sound and can be heard with very great efforts.
But even that low pitch sound can be heard in when you have a prolonged PR, because the distance of S4 from P is about 160 milliseconds. So if you have a short PR, then you don't hear it, a normal. If you have a prolonged PR or you have a 2:1 AV block, then you can hear it well, even without LV dysfunction. So when you have LV dysfunction, then the PR tends to get prolonged as you sort of relieve the LV dysfunction, the PR can come back and you cannot hear S4 anymore. So let's be prepared to answer all the S4 also. Yes, okay, go ahead.
Tunil. Yes, is E by E prime helpful in patients of LVOT obstruction, dynamic LVOT obstruction?
Or is it helpful somewhere else? That's what he wants to ask.
You told E by E prime is more than 14. Is it helpful in dynamic LVOT obstruction?
No, he did not say that. I asked him what was it. He said he's not measured it. Because he did not find it useful. I just said what is the criteria. He said it should be more than 15 to say is a muscle disease vis-a-vis pericardial disease.
Okay. Okay, go ahead.
So this is a cat tracing on 200 mg scale size to aortic pressure tracing with initial spike and later dome. This is the simultaneous LV and aortic pressure tracing on 200 mg scale with after premature ventricular contraction, there is a rise in ventricular pressure of around 180 and fall in aortic pulse pressure, which is classical of HCM, suggestive of broken row, brown or marrow sign.
Why does it occur?
So there are two mechanisms described. One is hemodynamic, and at the cellular level, during hemodynamics with PVC, there is during PVC the ventricular emptying is less, and so there is increased preload for next beat, which with Frank-Starling law, which increases contractility, and at the cellular level also there is a more calcium for the next beat, which increases forceful contraction. And so with PVC there will be increase in LV pressure, but that pressure is not transmitted to the aorta due to LVOT obstruction. So pulse pressure
because of increased contractility. So basically this is a common mechanism. That otherwise is the other one is a more of an intrinsic mechanism.
Yes, sir. That's it.
Okay, so I think
how do you
manage? Yeah.
Sorry. How do you now have this patient now of HCM? How do you risk stratify this patient with the current guidelines?
Sir, as a patient is in class 3 symptom and with there is history of possibility of sustained VT. So first we'll go for medical optimal medical therapy with beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. And patient will be evaluated for arrhythmic burden with Holter and event recorders. So, and but there is a history of syncope is there. The patient there is a class 1 indication for ICD, sir. Sorry, class 2A indication for ICD.
So that's a management wise. Otherwise, what are the parameters that you commonly use to risk stratify these patients? If you can just name them quickly.
Yes, sir. One is family history of sudden death. One previous history of syncope. Then
thickness gradient
more than 50 and septal thickness more than 30 mm or
and septal thickness more than
30
LVH more than 30
then recently LG lead gadolinium more than 15% on MRI if there is associated LV apical aneurysm. And if EAP is less than 50%, these candidates should be considered for ICDs.
Why do you think that EF only 50% is an indication for or considered a high-risk feature in this?
Sir, in SCM, the EF is usually high due to increased contractility, higher on side 70-80%.
Because even the mild decrease in LV function in a SCM is indicative of a very severe myocardial disarray, and these patients are having a already severe relaxation abnormality. So that is why even a minute decrease in the SCM patients is not acceptable, and these patients warrant immediate intervention. So that is very important. So whenever you describe, you don't wait for a ominous heart failure or heart failure like signs in this SCM patient. You have to intervene immediately.
Yes, sir.
What is the blood pressure response? You not see?
Yes, sir. Blood pressure response is also involved, sir. Abnormal blood pressure response is also an indication for...
No. So, my question to you is that in the newer guidelines, do you think that this is any more a criteria that is included in the risk stratification, the blood pressure response? Blood pressure response indicates poor prognosis, failure to rise more than 20 and lack of unfall more than 20, isn't it? So, that is what the response is. But this is no more included because of what four factors? There are four compounding factors that influence this blood pressure response. So in the newer risk stratification tools, blood pressure response is no more. You can go and read it in the new
guide. I have not mentioned it now. Yeah.
Yeah, they have fizzled it out. Okay. NSVT on ambulatory monitor is a very important sign that you should be aware that frequent runs more than 3, longer than 10 beats and faster. So all these things are more of a interest for completion sake. You should all be aware of. So now you have a patient who has a gradient of 160 with severe LVH, you say. What are the modalities? What will be your approach? What would you do till the time you give him a definitive treatment?
Till the time, sir, general care, patient should be advised for to avoid dehydration. And general advice, patient can be advised mild to moderate intensity exercise. Severe intensity exercise should be avoided. The first drug will be, sir, choice is beta blocker, and with patient does not tolerate or symptom persists in spite of adequate beta blockers, then we can add another drug like verapamil or disopyramide. And still patient remains symptomatic, patient will be a candidate.
So you add verapamil or you replace it?
Replace, sir. I will be replaced by...
And where would you like to avoid verapamil?
When there is a severe resting gradient with hypotension, it should be avoided.
Or a severe pulmonary arterial hypertension.
Hypertension. Yes. Three conditions you will
have. Can you combine three drugs?
No, sir. It should be like either beta blocker with disopyramide or verapamil with disopyramide.
You yes, don't combine three drugs, correct?
Yes. So how do you write a prescription? You start with metoprolol. What is the beta blocker you would like to use here?
Selective beta blockers without intrinsic activity should be used, sir. Metoprolol.
So you start with what and then you go to what dose? So what is your criteria?
I will start with beta blocker metoprolol, sir, with 25 milligram BD, and will be escalated up to 200 mg per day.
What are you watching? You're watching the heart rate, you're watching the gradient, you're watching symptoms. What are you watching?
Optimal effects like heart rate, if there is bradycardia less than 60, we can discontinue, and also side effects of beta blocker like fatigue. And
so you will keep on building beta blockers till you get to the maximum dose,
yes,
or side effects occur. And at what point of time do you decide that now this is not working?
When there is a side effects of beta blocker like bradycardia or fatigue.
That you have said. But you know, you said if it is not working, then I will add disopyramide.
Symptoms still persist. Symptoms of our patients.
Symptoms are going to disappear or the gradient is going to fall significantly.
Tell us that beta blockers are effective more for the resting gradients or they are more effective for the provocative gradients or exercise related gradients. In which group of HCM patients they are more effective?
For a provocative gradient, exercise gradient, it is more effective.
Yes, they are more effective for the provocative gradient. So if you have a resting gradient of approximately 120 or 100, do you think beta blocker would be, though it is given commonly, obviously, with an effect on almost 50 to 75% of the patients who respond, which one is the best drug in such cases?
Disopyramide is best.
Disopyramide in combination with the beta blocker would be a very, very appropriate choice in these conditions. So one should always remember that.
Why do you want to combine the two? Why with the disopyramide you would always like to give a beta blocker? Because if you have?
The disopyramide has a propensity to accelerate the AV nodal
condition. AV nodal condition. So you need a AV nodal blocking agent. That's perfect. Any other new drug, quickly, if you can tell, before we have Dr. Kamal's lecture, quickly.
Ranolazine and mavacamten are the new drugs.
Mavacamten.
Yes.
Just in one word, if you can explain, one line, that how does mavacamten act?
Sir, it decreases the myocardial bridging by decreasing ATP.
So basically, it's very simple that one should remember that the myosin is in an active form or in an inactive form. So what it does is it converts from the active to the inactive form. So that is why. And the opposite of, one can obviously, if you are doing good, one can obviously ask the opposite of this particular phenomena, which drug is very important, new drug that has emerged as a potential target for heart failure. What is that drug? You can just name
it.
Galactic trial, kise aaya hai? Just for a completion. O se start hota hai, Olmi.
Oma come to you.
Captain, so that is one of the drugs. Jo usko inactive se active form mein le aata hai and increase the myocardial contraction. They should be just aware of all these things.
Yes.
So quickly now, you have a resting gradient of 160 in this patient. Patient is possibly a target for both. What would be your choice and why in these patients? If he requires an ICD, would you give it before or would you give it after the definitive treatment?
Will be after evaluation, will be ICD after will be better choice, sir.
Sure? Are you sure?
Yes, sir. Because patient already had one episode of VT and creating a scar can again increase the...
Why after?
So these patients generally are given often a single coil ICD before the procedure. This will give an advantage to this patient. Okay. You are able to once you already have a risk factor, particularly in this case, you said that the patient has probably an arrhythmic palpitation. So giving an ICD earlier would be a better one. You should go and read that why single coil ICDs are better. What are the mechanisms? When do you give a dual coil ICD? What are the indications? How is dual chamber pacing is helpful? So all these things you must complete. Okay. That is very important. Now, alcohol ablation. If you have very good expert, good center, you have both the facilities, best of the operators, why and which modality should be chosen?
In this patient,
I say you go for alcohol ablation. That's a very easy modality, perfect case. Why would you say yes and why would you say no? Vehemently yes and vehemently no.
If there is a no any structural abnormality of mitral wall or coronary artery disease, we'll go for
okay. Agreed. That's a smart answer. Very good answer. That if he does not have a if he does not have any company abnormality, no coronary artery disease, so you can definitely go for an alcohol. But
young versus old?
Yes, sir.
Young versus old, is there any study or data which says young patients you do this, old patients you do this?
Young
less than 40, more than 40?
More than 40, alcohol septal ablation should be there, sir. And in young patients, should be myectomy should be done.
LBBB, RBBB, we already discussed. Something else, one you already mentioned, correct. What is the
septal thickness? Difference
in the outcome between the two? What is more, definitely more in this, definitely less than this. But rest all are okay. Invasive, non-invasive, contrast, non-contrast, everything is okay. But one thing that is more common in doing alcohol septal ablation versus myectomy. Complete this is always more. What is more?
CHB is more common in...
Correct. Complete heart blocks are always more in alcohol septal ablation as compared to myectomy.
What are the chances of success of alcohol septal ablation once you have a gradient above 100? It has very high recurrences. Every 1 in 5 case would recur. And probably if the gradients are very, very high, myectomy is generally considered to be the treatment of choice. In the newer guidelines, you can go and read it. So this is very, very clear. So you should be aware that why you are choosing one particular treatment. Even in younger individuals, 40, 50, myectomy is the treatment of choice in these patients because such high recurrence, they require recurrent procedures in this particular case, okay?
Nobody talks about dual chamber pacing now.
Yeah, so that is what I was, sir, I did mention that.
I remember long time back in one of the CSI meetings, Dr. Khalilullah, Dr. Sethi and Dr. Gambhir, you know, they presented this case of, you know, they immediately sort of during the conference, they came up with this idea of pacing the right ventricle in the cases of IHSS. And then they showed that the septum is moving away. I remember that case and it won
given the limitation of the time, this very important question that what is the role of sequential pacing? Remember, sequential AV pacing has been very long discouraged, but the newer guidelines and there's strong indication that they decrease the gradient by almost how much you should go and read. The newer evidence, they have done the meta-analysis, almost 50% decrease in AV gradient by the sequential pacing. That is the advantage of sequential pacing.
Yes, so, the same Dr. Khalila Saab ne to sirf ventricular pacing se dikhaya tha. Aur CSI tribal award mila tha us saal humko yaad hai. Lekin ho gaye 25 baras. 20-25 baras aur zyada.
Okay, go ahead.
It'll be more.
Okay. Dr. Sharma, would you take the questions if you don't mind, sir?
And I think first let him complete that keynote lecture.
Okay.
Kamal, you just started keynote lecture.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Sunil, can you stop sharing?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for presenting. Thank you for having a learning experience. Good case presentation. Yeah, is my screen visible?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so I think a lot of important questions have already been discussed by respected faculties. So there's probably hardly much that I probably will be adding to this, but let me try to summarize and comprehensively talk about the important aspects of the same. So historically, of course, Thiers was the first guy to actually describe it in literature. Where it came as to be described as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And of course, Brunwald is another guy who's done a lot of work for the first diagnosis clinically in 1960s. And then it has got multiple names like IHSS, muscle subaortic stenosis, or HOCM. It's of course the most common genetic cardiovascular disorder, which is characterized by heterogeneous clinical expression with mutations which encode for the cardiac sarcomere proteins with 1:1 male-female ratio, and one of the important causes of sudden death in competitive sports amongst young. Of course, the biggest risk, as we were discussing during case, is not just only VTs, but also risk of atrial fibrillation. And we discussed what are the various mechanisms. Heart failure-related disability is, of course, something that these patients have to deal with at any age. Like this case we discussed, just a 30-year-old, and we saw the pulmonary venous hypertension to huge extent, even on chest x-ray with grade 3 dyspnea. Apical variant and another variant, which is very commonly described to be more predominantly present in Japan. But its preponderance in Indian subcontinent would be also very high, though the published literature is pretty minuscule. So coming to prevalence, previously it was believed 1 in 500 when it was primarily an echocardiographic diagnosis. But now, subsequent to the availability of genetic testing or cardiac imaging, like cardiac MR, prior epidemiological studies, which did not take into account the genetic studies, came to a 0.2% prevalence. But now, from the data that is existing with the newer modalities of imaging and genetic analysis, now we know that the prevalence is higher. A lot of subset of clinically undiagnosed actually were leading to this low prevalence, and actual prevalence is something like 0.5%, which is 1 in 200 patients. So hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is defined as a genetically determined heart muscle disease. Up to 60 to 70% are caused by mutation in one of the several sarcomere genes, which encode for various components of the contractile apparatus of the sarcomere of the heart. And depending upon the site and extent, you can have multiple findings in these patients, which of course range from outflow obstruction, but primarily being driven by myocardial disarray, which is leading to diastolic dysfunction, ischemia, and anatomical abnormalities, along with the drag effect of the mitral leaflet leading to mitral regurgitation. This is a classical picture from Brunwald's textbook of cardiology, of histology, as well as a pathological specimen. And it shows how, to huge extent, the coronary arteries also have hypertrophied media of the intramural as well as the muscular supply being so hypertrophied that the ischemia is driven not only by the disarray and the hypertrophied fibroblasts, replacement with the fibroid tissue, but also because of the small lumen because of the hypertrophied medium. There are various molecular substrate of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. 65% actually patients don't have any significant mutation, or they have variants of uncertain significance. They have mutation, but we don't know what we are dealing with. Only in the 35% of patients at CM, we would be able to find out one of the important mutation which has got significant molecular substrate and its inheritance disorders. Amongst that, it is the MYBPC3, which constitutes 16% of the cases, while MYH7, which is 13%, which is basically beta myosin heavy chain versus the beta cardiac myosin binding protein C. So cardiac myosin binding protein C amongst the significant mutation is the highest determinant mutation, which is of significance and has been found in the series by Maron et al. So it's basically an autosomal disorder with almost 11 and more genes which have been found. And as I said, 70% of the significant mutations are primarily either beta myosin heavy chain or myosin binding protein C, which account for the 70%. Only 35% have the subgroup of the other variants or other. And as I said, 65% have unknown significant mutations. Thick filament mutations, as this has been called, these two mutations, MHC and MYBPC3, are called as thick filament mutations. They are actually having clinically more severe and worse outcome compared to thin, which is like the Z filament or the Y filament, etc., which have the mutations and the lesser significance in terms of clinical outcomes. The mimics, as was discussed, one of the important is the LAMP2 cardiomyopathy, which is basically histologically or even genetically only detected. Otherwise, it mimics very classically a patient, the HOCM patients, and it's very lethal even after ICD implantation before 25 years of age, and it requires nothing short of heart transplant to salvage the patient. Coming to natural history, Maron, as we know, has done a lot of work into this, and they pre-classically describe 1% annual mortality for adult HCM and 2% for children who present with HCM. Arderson's data described a mean age of presentation of 28 with 1/6 dying because of SCD, 10 to 15% dying of heart failure, as was Dr. Mandal's question in Viva, and 3 to 4% of the patients develop burnout at CM, which is very often detected, even clinically. These patients have very high mortality rate compared to 1% is 3 to 4% is like four times. Patients with aborted sudden cardiac death have a much higher mortality. So even compared to LV dysfunction, patients with aborted SCD without LV dysfunction have 11% per year mortality, which is again 11 times more than those who don't have anything. In Nashimura's series, they were the one, as Professor Narain was describing, that how it was presented in CSI. But Nashimura was the first one to describe actually dual chamber pacing in HOCM, and the physiology of that same was touched upon. And myectomy was described by Maron, and Agrawal et al. In their meta-analysis had compared alcohol septal ablation versus myectomy, where alcohol septal ablation had higher residual gradient, as Professor Mohit had pointed out, more incidence of RBBB, complete heart block, and need for pacemaker. But there was no difference amongst the two in terms of NYHA class or mortality, but a redo procedure rate again was higher in the subgroup of patients. So pathophysiologically speaking, the Venturi effect, which has been classically described because of the drag effect per se, leading to the anterior septal motion of the systolic anterior motion of the mitral leaflet contacting the ventricular septum mid-systole, with various other morphological obstructive pathologies also coming into play, and the MR or the LVOT obstruction not being primarily or only being determined by SAM. You have narrowed LVOT diameter itself because of increased septal wall thickness. Apically positioned papillary muscles can tether the mitral valve plane also, or reorienting it towards the septum. Elongated leaflet itself has been found in a lot of these patients postpartly and even in antenatally in MR and echocardiographically. Restricted mobility of the posterior mitral leaflet is also responsible genetically in the formation of the two mitral leaflets, and congenital anomaly of anterior papillary muscle insertion into the anterior leaflets, which also produces sometimes mid-cavity obstruction, not just the LVOT obstruction. So the magnitude of LVOT obstruction is of course determined by the duration of the MVLNS IVS contact rather than the just the amount of contact or the amount of drag. The duration of this for which the obstruction is present is more important factor. Dynamic nature of LVOT obstruction is sometimes asked. So we should understand, which was discussed again in pathophysiology, that inducing the LVOT obstruction can be done by either reducing the preload, decreasing the afterload, or increasing the inotropy. So the drugs like nitrates will reduce the preload. ACE, ARBs, CCBs, ARNIs all reduce the afterload, and digoxin or IV inotropes will increase the inotropy. All of them combined together will increase and worsen the LVOT obstruction. Preload is also reduced by dehydration, by diuretics, sudden option of changing in posture, Valsalva maneuver, or even amyl nitrate or similar medications have been described. Inotropy can be increased by fever, exercise, even isoproterenol or dobutamine infusion, and of course, we all know Brockenberg-Bernwald marrow phenomenon. So reducing the LVOT obstruction would require the things just opposite to the same, squatting or lying with legs elevation would increase the venous return and preload, while isometric hand grip will increase the afterload. All of these maneuver hence will increase the LVOT size or LV cavity size, and hence will reduce the LVOT obstruction. Drugs that can reduce inotropism would include, of course, beta blockers and non-dihydropyridines, calcium channel blocker, and of course, disopyramide. So roughly to remember, there's a gross rule that we all read in Harrison's 20 years back, that all murmurs decrease except HOCM and MVP on Valsalva and standing. So this is a rough dictum. You can beat around this also with some of the other maneuvers and murmurs, but this is a rough dictum to remember that almost all murmurs decrease HOCM and MVP on Valsalva and standing. There are various variants of HOCM have been described. Again, this was discussed to some extent in the Viva. You can have HCM with not a grossly thickened valve. You can have actually a genetic non-manifesting genotype without a negative phenotype where the valve thickness is normal, and they can like later on present with it. They might be just a carriers. But of course, the classically, as has been studied and described, is the asymmetric septal hypertrophy with IVS-PW ratio more than 1.3. But a lot of times we find sigmoid septum in elderly patient, mid-cavity obstruction, with the hypertrophy, free wall hypertrophy, which is very unusual, but can it also be presented? LV wall thickening, which can be present in the burnout phase, predominantly apical hypertrophy, which is again common in Asian, especially Japan, Japanese people. Concentric with cavity obstruction is something also known. 20% have been reported to have biventricular hypertrophy in the literature, and mild to moderate symmetric hypertrophy, which can also be present in early and can be misdiagnosed as hypertensive hypertrophy unless it's been followed up or looked for or assessed for genotypically or by family history. So there is no specific type which you can stamp as an HOCM or HCM, but there can be multiple variants or one or the other. You remember the non-obstructive HCM can also be a common finding. 10% patients with gradient less than 30% can actually have class 3-4 symptoms. And this to be huge extent that they may warrant transplant. 5 times though, they are less likely to progress to class 3-4, but they are more likely, and hence they are more likely to stay benign, but they account for 1/3 of the asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic cases, and hence they are, it's important to diagnose HCM, which are non-obstructive in nature. Coming to signs and symptoms, which were exquisitely discussed by my panelists, dyspnea, fatigue, atypical or typical angina, pre-syncope, syncope, and palpitation. Orthopnea, PND are uncommon. Again, we touched upon it. Lightheadedness or AF and ventricular ectopy both contributing to palpitation. Mechanisms of heart failure are primarily driven by diastolic properties rather than systolic failures. But again, systolic dysfunction as a burnout is not uncommon. Mitral regurgitation sometimes can be severe enough to lead to symptoms of heart failure. And impaired LV emptying and LVOT obstruction can also lead to increased LV and diastolic pressure and hence failure. Classically, chest pain occurs in 25 to 30% of the patient, the classical angina, as we call. And these are usually precipitated or worsened by heavy meals, as Professor Narain was asking. And it worsened with nitrate sometimes that has been described, but need not always be true. Increase by an increase in the myocardial oxygen demand or reduction in blood flow with medial hypertrophy of the coronary vessel in the histology, as I showed you the slide. And patients with HCM can have an acute myocardial infarction appear are more likely to present with NST MI rather than ST elevation MI if they have the similar finding. A physical examination, again, we touched upon bifid pulse, bisphariance, twice beating pulses, or bisphariance in HOCM is different from AS with AR. JVP can have a prominent A wave, primarily driven by Bernheim effect, a hypertrophied septum actually impinging on the RV and the filling of the RV and the back pressure transmission of the same by reducing the ventricular compliance can have a prominent A wave. Double or triple ripple, as it is called, the triple ripple being the two bifid apex and the LA kick, all three contributing to the same, making it look like a triple ripple rather than just a bifid apex. S4 is usually present and palpable. So these are the findings. S3 usually is absent unless you have LV aneurysm or you have a burnout dilated cardiomyopathy. Heaving apex is common. Again, most important finding is the dynamic auscultation, which should be learned in detail and was touched upon. ECG, when you come to investigation, it's abnormal in 90% of the proband, 75% even of the asymptomatic relatives. So they can usually pick up. So once you diagnose a normal ECG, absolutely flat bang on normal ECG, you are very much likely to be sure, especially in a fully grown up adult, that probably you are not dealing with a proband who's likely to be mutated but asymptomatic so far, which include STD changes, left atrial enlargement, deep or narrow Q waves, and decreased R waves, but though none of the finding is pathognomonic. So sometimes some element of HCM, as they say, asymmetric T and deep symmetric T versus the convex and concave down T, that's how you differentiate a T wave inversion of HCM from T waves of NSTMI or subarachnoid hemorrhage, which is a classical picture given in Brunwald's book of cardiology. Holter or an ambulatory ECG monitoring ranging from 24 to 48 hours are important to assess the arrhythmia burden. And up to 14 days with loop recorder can also be used to increase detection of non-sustained arrhythmias. Non-sustained tachyarrhythmia is associated with increased risk of sudden cardiac death. Exercise testing, though some people mention it as a relative contraindication, was previously being used extensively when the imaging was not so much available to look at the hemodynamic response. Primarily, a hypotension during exercise is a bad prognostic marker. Normal blood pressure should include maximal upright exercise testing with at least 20 millimeter increase in systolic pressure. However, 20 to 40% patients with HCM, they fail to augment the baseline pressure and the blood pressure may actually fall following exercise. So during exercise, those who develop angina, mark STT changes, hypotension, atrial fibrillation, or even rise in the gradient, you can do a dynamic echo. And if that, or sinus arrhythmias are the patients who are at worst prognosis and require early intervention. So this includes exercise testing based on development of symptoms, as was mentioned, as Professor Mohit Gupta was asking, an increase in development of LVOT obstruction, failure of blood pressure to rise, arrhythmias, ST depression, and development of MR. So the mimics or the induction of pressure gradient can sometimes be done during a stress echo or by amyl nitrate, dobutamine, or isopropanol. And despite the LVOT gradient, there is not a predictable correlation of symptoms and LVOT obstruction. Again, echo was touched upon. A wall thickness previously was called as cutoff as 18 to diagnose HCM 20 years back. Now it's 15. So anybody who you image as more than 15, you should probably be more suspicious looking for overall picture and clinical evaluation apart from genotypic assessment. A wall thickness of 13 can also be considered diagnostic if one of the family member already has an HCM. Most common location, of course, is the basal anterior septum in continuity with the anterior free wall, with the posterior septum being the third commonest site. The presence and the extent of LVH is evaluated in diastole at the level of mitral valve and papillary muscle. So it's a diastolic measurement, not systolic measurement. SAM, again, is frequently found which positions the mitral valve into the LVOT optin, but it's not a compulsory requirement to diagnose. LVOT obstruction, when there is in contact with the mitral valve in the septum, greater the contact, more is the obstruction. So 2D echocardiography is a class 1 indication, not only for measurement of the thickness or recording the SAM, but also in symptomatic patients with resting or provoked gradients of less than 50, in standing or sitting or semi-prone to detect provocable LVOT. So in patients with HCM and he's undergoing an echo, you not only do an echo in supine, you'll have to do the echo asking the patient to stand up, sit up and do squat maybe to look for what happens to his dynamic gradient. It's very well shown that those who have LVOT obstruction, the outcomes are very different. Those who don't have obstruction, 10-year survival is almost 83% as compared to myectomy patient, isolated myectomy patient, as compared to non-operated or obstructive patient, where the 10-year survival is just 61%. And again, freedom from death in 10-year after the gradient measurement, also you can see the difference being 90% versus 75% at 10 years in this subgroup of patient. So this is how the myectomies can actually relieve the obstruction. This is a classic example from the textbook. And this is how sometimes an LV angiogram and the tail and the diamond shape and the two difference between the two gradients of the flow can be used in MR and LVOT gradients, and the subaortic obstruction and the valvular obstruction can be used to differentiate the two. SAM, of course, can be, as was discussed, duration of contact and it's primarily systolic anterior motion that you have to look and chase. And these are the gradients. Again, Professor Narain had touched upon them, less than 10 mm, more than 10 mm, and the duration, more than 30%, less than 30%, or the systole, how you grade as 1, 2, 3, and 4. And this is not specific only for HOCM, but it's been used for all other causes where SAM is present. Sometimes you can actually find ectopic coming in and gradient actually rising even on echocardiography, though it is usually a CAT finding as it is described, but you can have a variation in gradient even with an ectopic or an atrial fibrillation. You can see how the gradient increases and hence the pressure difference does not, the rise in the pressure post ectopic and the of the aorta is overcome by the obstruction being rising. Cardiac MR has now come into a big play. It's important because it picks up late gadolinium enhancement, and which is a marker of myocardial fibrosis, which is a predictor of sudden cardiac death. It picks 40% of the aneurysms which are actually missed on echo, because in echo we tend to focus only on the hypertrophies and the thicknesses, but sometimes you can have small aneurysms and pockets which are actually missed out from in HCM on echocardiography. They can be picked up on MR. The predictors of sudden cardiac death have been the MR cutoffs of LV wall index being 100% sensitive. So males with 91 and females with 69 gram per meter square they are predictor of sudden cardiac death with 100% sensitivity, while maximal wall thickness of more than 30 is a specific sign of sudden cardiac death. LG is a predictor of arrhythmia. It can also help to quantify RVOT and RV hypertrophy. Also look at microvascular dysfunction, regional abnormalities, diastolic properties, and structural abnormalities like myocardial crypts, which can later on present with development of aneurysm. Cardiac cath, again, when the data is discrepant or when the endomyocardial biopsy is planned for non-sarcomeric disease like Fabry's amyloids or Danone disease, that's only the preferred indication these days. Otherwise, patients who are being planned for coronary angiogram, of course, you will end up taking an LVOT pullback gradient. So invasive is to evaluate left and right heart and PVR in patients recommended for being heart transplant or circulatory, mechanical circulatory support is class 1. And symptomatic, inconclusive, non-invasive cardiac imaging is 2B indication. There are no other indications for doing an invasive assessment, which was discussed. So this is how the spike in dome, which was again discussed in our case presentation. Brunnwald-Breckenridge phenomena, again discussed in our case presentation. So the augmentation of the gradient, again, you can look at the various maneuvers and Valsalva and nitroglycerin, venodilatation versus venous return, and how those impact the dynamic auscultation findings in these patients was also discussed in our case presentation today. HOCM versus valvular AS, we need to differentiate from one of the differentials. Again, dynamic auscultation helps to differentiate the two. We all know anatomically it's the within the LV and it may be variable and labile. And the timing of upstroke of initial LV and aortic pressure tracing are similar and rapid in upstroke. Somebody had asked in the box, chat box, why do we do the peak gradient and not the mean gradient? It's because of this reason. A ventricular premature beat can, of course, distinguish with between the two. The other differential, as people talk about, is athlete's heart, where we look at the LV cavity dimension. If it's less than 45, it goes usually in favor of HCM, while if its cavity is more than 55, it goes in favor of athlete's heart. Again, the regional pattern or focal pattern goes in favor of pathological HCM. LA enlargement is present, bizarre ECG finding, abnormal filling pressure, family history all go in favor of HCM, while VO2 increase by 110% if possible during exercising and decrease LV thickness by deconditioning will go in favor of athlete's heart. So once we diagnose a case of HCM, look at an echocardiography, look at the LVOT obstruction. If the patient is asymptomatic, you need not do anything for the subgroup of patients. In mildly symptomatic, again, you'll subject them to medical therapy only. Whether they have asymptomatic obstructive or asymptomatic non-obstructive. Only in obstructive, severe 3 or 4 class, functional class, asymptomatic patient, that despite the medical therapy, you will end up them subjecting to surgical myectomy or alcohol septal ablation. While in non-obstructive, we don't have that choice but to subject them to transplant in the subgroup of patient. Again, we know from genotype-phenotype studies, again, a prognostic pathway as it has been described. If there are no symptoms, you just don't do a treatment. If patient has sudden death risk, you do ICD. And if a patient has got heart failure features, then based on class 3-4, you'll advise them to go for myectomy or ICD. Again, atrial fibrillation, you would prefer warfarin and cardioversion or RF ablation. Data with NOACs are very minimal, and most of the data has been existing for warfarin. So this is from Brunnwald's textbook, not to mention of NOAC, primarily warfarin. Our drugs were discussed, and mavacamten was again discussed. Trial was pioneer HCM trial, basically a drug that mitigates symptom by allosteric myosin inhibitor action, and that's how the drug works. And as I mentioned, disopyramide is a third option which you can combine to ameliorate, but never combine the three drugs. So all three are basically the commonly used drugs are negative inotropic drugs. And as was discussed, CCBs for resting gradient, you use disopyramide. Exercise gradient, you use beta blockers. And when you can't use beta blockers, you choose calcium channel blockers, or beta blockers can of primarily be of importance in reducing angina, while CCBs reduce angina by improving microvascular dysfunction, because calcium mass handling is the pathophysiological abnormality that lies at the level of intracellular mechanisms. Symptomatic patient, those who have significant gradient, initial therapy, monotherapy is chosen between the two. As I mentioned, there is no role of combining the three drugs together. In patients who have persistent heart failure, LVOT obstruction, despite monotherapy, we can combine with disopyramide, either choosing beta blocker or CCBs. A vasodilator diuretic should be used with caution. A disopyramide, we should remember two important things. It can accelerate the AV nodal conduction, again, which was discussed, if patient develops AF, and that's why you need to combine it with a beta blocker specially, or maybe a calcium channel blocker. Another problem is the torsads, because it can cause a QT prolongation. It should not be used in patients if QT is already prolonged, because it can concurrently treated with amiodarone, cetalol, it can be a proarrhythmic concern, and it has got anticholinergic side effects that also should be remembered, and these patients can come with, you know, retention of urine, so you should be cautious about this aspect as well. Mavakemtan, it's a study called Pioneer HCM study, which was basically a 48-week study, and it resulted in LVOT gradient decreasing by 73 millimeters of mercury. And LVOT post-exercise by 93 millimeters. So we have a significant improvement, and that's hence a very promising drug. It causes high grade of actin-myosin cross-linking being prevented in these subgroup of patients. And even BNP, lateral E by E prime, or LA volume index were reduced. Significant improvement in LV septal thicknesses without change in ejection fraction. And even KCC, Kansas City Cardiomyopathy Questionnaire Quality Life Index, was also improved significantly, which remained consistent all throughout the period of the study, with almost an average one NYHA class improvement. Though this is not yet a standard care of therapy, but it should become so. Very promising data from Pioneer HCM, which was published in last year itself. And now we have Explorer study, which is phase 3. And once that data comes, I think it will become a standard care to be available across worldwide. Now, this is important when a patient comes with acute deterioration. The drug of choice is to improve the blood pressure, and that the drug of choice is phenylephrine, because it is, when injected in saline, it provides it at the rate of, say, 100 to 180 micrograms per minute. It will increase the blood pressure and decrease the LVOT obstruction. You should avoid the drugs that can increase LVOT obstruction, vasopressors like vasopressin itself, or IV beta blocker once the blood pressure is there is something that you can again give, which especially choosing propranolol over sametoprolol because of the unopposed alpha. Beta 1 and beta 2 both are blocked, and there is unopposed alpha, which can theoretically cause peripheral vasoconstriction, and hence the alpha can cause increase in the SVR. While selective will not have that advantage, though there are no head-to-head comparison between, say, propranolol and metoprolol, but this is a pharmacological advantage that people have quoted. Another important thing is an HCM patient undergoing surgery. When a patient is planned for something, again, it's a disorder like pheochromocytoma, you know, you need to keep these patients extremely hydrated. They are usually when they complain of edema or breathlessness, you should understand that this is not primarily volume overload alone. A lot of them might already be receiving diuretics or maybe have been depleted of volume because of nil by mouth. And hence, it's very important to hydrate them well. Hypotension, again, should be treated with alpha-1 agonists. And limiting contractility, tachycardia, and oxygen demand by a background metoprolol or beta blocker is a drug of choice. Sometimes you may require if it's diagnosed on table. But again, nitrates. Nitroglycerin or prusside should be avoided completely. So we've discussed this, that what are the high-risk parameters, prior cardiac arrest, family history, syncope, VT, hypertrophy more than 30, LGE in MAMR more than 15%, EF less than 50%. Recommended therapies for these subgroup of patient in patient with HCM with major non-invasive risk factor should be used. ICD implantation primarily in prevention is recommended in those who have family history, sudden death, unexplained syncope, high gradient, wall thickness, LA diameter, invisibility, and you can add HCM risk score, which is available now on multiple apps. Secondary prevention, of course, anybody who has got more than 1 year of life expectancy. Recommended other therapies would include in patients with catheter ablation for radio frequency in patients with HCM would be recorded in this patient who have largely been reserved for the subgroup with LV apical aneurysm only. So success of catheter ablation is due to the fact that the structural nidus for VT is common at the junction of aneurysm and myocardium. Predisposing factor for patients with in the risk factors of atrial fibrillation as in HCM would be, CHADS-VAS2 is neither validated. Amiodarone is the drug of choice. Beta blocker are usually administered to control the rate. And patients with history of AF undergoing surgical myectomy can undergo a maze procedure simultaneously. Digoxin should be avoided, and rhythm control sometimes can be chosen in atrial fibrillation in these subgroup of patients. Myectomy, average muscle removed is 8 grams, between 3 to 15 grams is what they do. Extension of myectomy right up to the papillary muscle can actually cause widening of the LVOT right up to the mid cavity and has been found to have better result outcomes. So a good surgeon not only chops off the muscle in the LVOT, but also resects it right up to the papillary, up to the insertion, hence relieving the all the obstructive pathophysiologies by the so-called Morrow procedure, which is done resecting the basal part of the muscle. So this is how the muscle myectomy is done, very small amount. And of course, complication, we have discussed complete heart block and ventricular septal rupture, aortic regurgitation. And mitral valve intervention can sometimes be required if there is anatomical abnormality. A lot of patients along with myectomy may end up getting a mitral valve replacement or mitral valve plication with repair. I'll call septal ablation with an OTW balloon of 3 ml, 95% alcohol to the first major septal perforator can produce an myocardial infarction like necrosis of that area. And this scar is often large, occupying 10% of the mass. And that's one reason people say that once you've done either of these two procedures, that's when it's probably wiser to insert an ICD. Again, in chosen patients selectively for this procedure are those with septal thickness more than 18, gradient more than 50, and no anomalous papillary abnormalities or significant coronary artery disease with a large compatible septal perforator. The benefit, of course, the gradient goes down from 65 to 15, provoke going down from 125 to 31, and good functional class improvement, but the risk being coronary artery dissection, large infarction, pericardial effusion, complete heart block, and arrhythmias. So advantages of myectomy would include immediately return of the normal contractility, 90 to 95% compared to 80 to 90% have the success rates, lower incidence of CHB, greater likelihood of a complete cure and no recurrences or need for second procedure, while alcohol septal ablation, of course, has got avoidance of a sternotomy, shorter stay, less risk of VSR, less expense, and ability to treat CAD simultaneously. So a repeat procedure is very common in patients who undergo alcohol septal ablation as compared to surgical myectomy, which is 2% versus 10% in alcohol septal ablation. Dual chamber pacemaker was already discussed, so for the sake of time, I will skip it. A patient that need to be chosen would be including LVOT gradients and transmural scar, myocardial septal ablation. They should not be performed, as I mentioned, in young patients. It's only in the elderly patient that you should choose it. Screening of family members is another important thing by genotype and phenotype. Family screening should include ECG and ACO. The guidelines have two different cutoffs, 21 and 12 versus 12 versus 18. The up-to-date mentions 18, Brunwald mentions 21. But the important thing is that you should keep screening them every year and beyond 18 every 5 years or beyond 21 every 5 years. So Brunwald says 21, up-to-date mentions at 18. But the more important is that you should keep looking at these patients beyond 21 every 5 years, between 12 to 21 every year, and less than 12 you can follow up as for the development of symptoms. The important 2020 guidelines, this is the current update. The new perspectives are for symptomatic HCM with LVOT, non-vasodilating beta blockers are recommended. If not tolerated, diltiazem are recommended or verapamil is recommended for dyspnea children less than 6 weeks old or for resting gradient over 100. For symptom refractory, all these patients, disopyramide can be added or septal reduction may be offered to high volume center. CHADS-VAS2, again, this is something that has come. Anticoagulation is recommended irrespective of CHADS-VAS2. Don't look at AF in these group with CHADS-VAS2, but direct anticoagulation, first line being warfarin, not NOVAX in these subgroup of patient. Pregnant HCM beta blockade should be continued, watching for the fetal growth. If anticoagulation is indicated, then low molecular weight heparin. So these are the three important updates. There is a huge 20-page guideline, but these are the three important updates that I thought that from 2020 update from ACC guideline on HCM, I thought should I touch upon. Thank you. Thank you for patient hearing.
Thanks, Kamal, for excellent discussion. I think it is helpful both for theory and practical examination. And most of the questions, I think they answered by the panelist and also in the
I think that. Yeah, Doctor,
why orthopnea?
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, carry on, sir. Carry.
Now, why orthopnea is uncommon in HCM? Did already mentioned, you know, that Kamal already mentioned the orthopnea and PND is uncommon in HCM. Why there are no guidelines for ICD in patients with HEPPEP, despite over 30% of these patients have sudden cardiac death? Mohit?
Sorry, repeat the question.
Not enough evidence of the benefit.
The ICD is indicated if you can document a VT. So, I mean, once you have a documentation like primary or secondary prevention, the guidelines that I mentioned, those are the subgroup where you can put an ICD. Otherwise, as Sarab is mentioning, there is no evidence, not enough trials or evidence to suggest that just by late gadolinium enhancement of fibrosis, you go ahead and put an ICD.
So, as far as the ICD guidelines are concerned, they are not governed by the ejection fraction or that thing. They have very, very clear indications for them. And the risk stratification has to be done. And according to that, only the ICD is given in these patients.
I think all other questions are being answered. No other questions.
Yeah, HCM mutation is present in majority of the patient. But the point is that 65% of the patients have mutation which has not enough clinical significance. So only 35% of the patient have significant mutation of significant prognostic value. That is what is meant. So all of them probably will have some amount of mutation, but of significant value are present only 35. So 65% of the patient have mutation of unknown significance. No. That is what it means.
This has been classified like that also. More than 2,000 mutations have been identified, and that is why the current panel, which is used to diagnose the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, is an 8-gene panel only. So you should always remember that it's a predominant 8-gene panel that is used for generally hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. As somebody has rightly mentioned that, you know, it's 30% and 70% ratio. Dr. Kamal was just telling you that only. You should be knowing about the reverse pulsus paradoxus, what are the mechanisms. You should be knowing about the mechanisms of chest pain, mechanisms of dyspnea in these patients, why is syncope is occurring in these patients, what are the complications. You should also be knowing about the pregnancy. Remember, the anticoagulant therapy, as Dr. Kamal mentioned, is never, never guided by the CHA2DS2 score in these patients. It's not indicated. The drugs of choice are, again, the vitamin K antagonists. These are things one should be knowing. Lifestyle modifications is significant. One can significantly reduce the gradient in these patients. So obesity present in 50 to 70% of the patients, hypertension also in 50% of the patients needs to be controlled in these number of patients. Lot of percentages and numbers to remember in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but remember, in case you forget, the gold mantra is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a disease of 12 to 25%. So whatever you mention, most of the things will actually fall in.
Yeah, somebody has asked, mavacamten trial is Explorer HCM and not Pioneer. No, Pioneer HCM is actually phase 2 trial, which phase established two. It was released in the ESC last year. And that's how it is positioned. Explorer HCM, I also touched upon, is yet to publish its data, which is phase 3. And I've shared the complete article of the Lancet where the Pioneer HCM was published. I have shared the link for the whole article.
Dr. Kamal, if I'm right, there is another molecule that is in the pipeline along the mavacamten, right?
Correct, CK-273, correct.
273, something like that. You know, someone should be
correct.
Just
so that's undergoing phase 2 trial
phase
right
two
now.
Trials. Yeah,
mavacamten, we know because it's now in phase 3. Phase 2 was successful and hence phase 3 is now designed.
Mavacamten is yet to approve get the FDA approval. If it comes, then probably after diazepamide and this thing, this will become the second line of drug of choice. Class 2 indication, it is probably it is going to receive.
I think already we passed 9.
Any question left out, sir? One last question, Dr. Sharma. Can you repeat the third update about pregnancy? I think somebody is asking.
I think Dr. Gupta was mentioning 3 updates about a pregnancy, right? Pregnancy?
The pregnancy, you must remember the pregnancy, it doesn't, most of the time, mortality is not much affected. The third stage has to be shortened significantly. Vaginal delivery is preferred in these patients, very important. And otherwise, if you go through the guidelines, they are very, very clearly, beautifully, Dr. Kamal has said, The 2020 guidelines is a must read. You can make a synopsis of them. All these questions are very nicely answered in these guidelines. There are five important points that one should remember about the pregnancy in the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And this is very low maternal mortality. If they are patients with AF, you anticoagulate with LMWH. Beta blockers are the drug of choice, even in the pregnant patients. And almost all of them are safe. You can use metoprolol, bisoprolol, labetalol, pindolol, and propranolol. Remember, the only drug that has shown to have a fetal risk in pregnancy, according to the new guidelines, is etanolol. Etanolol has some evidence of fetal risk, so they have advised not to use etanolol, surprisingly, in the patients of pregnant patients of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Okay, I think all question is over, Dr.
Yeah,
Mandal.
I think that's fine.
Yeah,
all question. Okay, so fantastic. Sir, I'm just taking this opportunity, rather privilege, to convey our immense thanks to Dr. Kamal Sharma, Dr. V.S.Narain, wonderful, Dr. Mohit Gupta, and Dr. Mandal. And also like to thank Dr. Sunil for handling all the questions very nicely. Barriers of questions you have been thrown. So I believe you have really nicely handled the things. So it is always a great pleasure to all of you, this great esteemed panelist in our program. And I believe you have shared a lot of important insight about this SCM, and it will be very important take-home pearls for all participants. I request all participants in this program, please participate as much as possible. And thanks for your patience hearing. And please take care of your all protection and safety measures.
How many students join?
Almost 700 PG students has joined so far. So their response is very good, sir. Yes, Dr. Narayan.
I was requesting that on one occasion we can have a philosophical lecture by Dr. Mohit Gupta.
Okay.
He is such a great speaker, and he has a lot of insight into the philosophy of life and afterlife. So I think we must have one good program where he can be the speaker and we'll just listen.
Sure.
Now, Mohit will speak on hemodynamics, no?
Yeah. So I think most important thing, sir, regarding this program, all the case presenter will be evaluated based on the marks given by the panelists. So based on that, first, second, third will be awarded from Ajanta Pharma. So I believe everybody will get a lot of insight, and I request all DNPG students or DNB students participate as much as possible. And thanks, Doctor, once again for your wonderful session. Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Dr. Sharma. Wonderful, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Narayan. Once again, thank you, Dr. Gupta. Wonderful. Thank you, sir. Dr. Mandal, wonderful, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, good night to all.
Thank you, sir.
Stay
thank
safe.
You. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Good night. Bye-bye.